שאלה אחת?
מחפש מיטאפ. אתה רוצה להירשם? רגע. מיטאפ. מיטאפ. M-E-T-U-P.
Most of those, that's it. You're here with us. It's actually very difficult to get out of here. You won't be able to. You actually won't be able to leave the to leave the talk if you want to, because these two doors on the top are closed, and this one as well. So sorry about that. We're going to have two talks today. I will start with Know Your Data, Test-Driven Data Science. By the way, can you hear me? All right, so we have lots of people. We have lots of people here. We were expecting 330, one third came. So, okay. I was actually afraid that we won't be able to accommodate you here in this auditorium. So you're right now, first of all, welcome to Checkpoint. Right now you're in the main building of Checkpoint. It's the headquarters. And you're actually between the new and the old building. So we built this new building recently, around a year ago, and we welcome you here. All right, so I will give you some introduction about Checkpoint, really, really short one, half a minute video. A little bit about myself. My name is Gershon Seliker. I manage the data science here at Checkpoint. It's one of the main data science teams. And I will elaborate more about the data science practice here at Checkpoint. Right. So what we're going to do in my short talk, I'm going to give you an overview about data science practice Checkpoint, dirty data and biased machine learning, top-down overview, test-driven data science overview and best practices, hands-on session on TDDA, TDDS. Who's familiar with TDDA? Wow. One. Yeah, all right. What's your name? Yotam. I was in your meetup 4 months ago. I took some materials from you, so you're ready for that. By the way, really nice meetup. So he's the only one who knows what the test-driven data science is. Wow, you will learn a lot here. Demonstration of Octopus. Right now you should be in what is Octopus it's all about. So I'm going to talk about Octopus, and then we'll have a discussion. So half a minute about Checkpoint. Sec.
Security. Everything is connected. Our cars,
infrastructure. I like my music taste. It was best indie folk. All right, now we can continue.
Welcome to the future of cybersecurity. Everything is connected. Our cars, infrastructure, cities. Cloud computing and the Internet of Things make everything faster and smarter for everyone, including cyber criminals. This is a new frontier in need of a new generation of cybersecurity. Checkpoint is here, ready for whatever comes. We've been securing the Internet since 1993. We created the first generation of cybersecurity, always with the same mission. To protect the connected world and enable the digital life for everyone.
Oh yeah, it's one of the data scientists, yeah.
Welcome to the future of cyber.
All right, so Checkpoint. Checkpoint, 5,000 employees from 2023. There are many products. It's actually a tricky question how many products Checkpoint has. Around 60 products. We have products in a network. We have products in. Sorry about that. It actually does work. Right. We have products with network, which is the. It's all started with network, the firewalls. Endpoint, it's a software installed on your computer. Cloud, and mobile. Cloud, by the way, we just acquired a company called Dome9, so we have their products. And mobile. I will just give you a short introduction. What are the data we data scientists here at Checkpoint work on. By the way, in the Checkpoint, right now there are around 35 data science machine learning practitioners. So that's a lot. We have a huge guild of data science. And one of the projects, of course, executables, network, it's all started with network. APKs, it's the Android app installers. Tweets and Telegram, by the way, it's the OSINT, part of the open source intelligence. Emails, documents, PDF, Excel, etc. That's the new thing. DOM 9, we started with monitoring serverless and cloud, AWS. We want to find if someone is started to mining Bitcoins and stuff like that on the company expense. And it's all data science. All right. How many of you been to Anaconda conference? Ah, there's one. All right. So you will be bored for 3 minutes. I'm going to show you a nice. I'm going to show you a nice video. It's a 3 minutes video, and it will be. And it's talked a lot about data, and I'm going to talk about a lot about data and data science and how it's important. In the end, in half an hour from now, if you will understand that data is really, really important, more than other things in machine learning, and you know how to test it and validate it. I did my. All right. So that's a parody.
There's one thing you should know about. I specialize in machine learning, a very special type of machine learning.
You're talking about deep learning.
So what's the most powerful thing in the business world? Capital? Intellectual property? No. A deployed deep learning model. This model's not accurate enough. We need to go deeper.
Models work with test data in the sandbox, but it's only when we try to integrate the real data in the production cluster that we realize something is not right. Think about it. How did we get here?
Started fitting the model.
Did you spend 2 weeks cleaning it? Did you have to pay a vendor to hydrate it? Did you have to blackmail a VP to run a VLOOKUP?
You're right. This must be test data. We're in the sandbox? Why don't all the data scientists try to escape?
In the sandbox, your data is clean. You have a GPU all to yourself, and your model accuracy is perfect. It's easier to just let yourself be deceived. It's called Piception.
Why are they shooting at us?
They're the IT team. We're running our Python models out of the sandbox. Why don't we write everything in Java?
Model's too accurate. Data is real. But is this a real cluster?
All our tools are here. Anaconda's installed. Everything just works. It's too perfect.
We're still in the sandbox. We have to get to the production cluster.
What is that? That's GDPR, but we don't have to worry about that until next month.
I do this, I get to go home.
Because we're trapped in a dream world within a dream world?
No, because my son has a soccer game at 6 and I need to get a jump on traffic.
There's no GPUs available.
It looks like the IT guys are using them to mine Bitcoin?
No, Dogecoin. Bitcoin mining uses too much energy and contributes to global warming. And Bitcoin has really become a settlement layer and not a currency. Dogecoin is a...
Shut up! Enough with all the stupid coins and cryptocurrency hype!
You kinda overfit!
Piception. The data is too clean. 2 weeks cleaning the data. Who actually cleans the data for 2 weeks? No way. We data scientists, we want to crunch data a little bit and then predict. And that's an issue, actually. So cleaning data is very, very important. And it's actually, it's a parody, 3 minutes, but it's so true. Especially if you're doing lots of deep learning and don't understand what's going on with your model. All right. So I'm going to talk a little bit about garbage in, garbage out, because we have a lot of them. So when we have garbage in, we get a model which is actually garbage. And sometimes it costs lots of money and even casualties. So for instance, this is an example of the Uber self-driving car. By the way, I'm going to go from top down, like all the way from these kind of examples and then to the instance, to the to data itself. So where we go. All right. So here we can see an Uber car. We can see it's a police car with a dash cam. And you will see that's a stoplight. These are already on red. And suddenly the Uber car, self-driving car, it just passes really quietly the red light. Like everything is totally fine. By the way, they didn't, it was the San Francisco, they didn't even receive an approval or a license to do this kind of test. And look at the chutzpah of the Uber people. What they're saying, it was a human error. And this is why we believe so much in making the roads safer by building self-driving vehicles. Not only they did this fuck up, they blamed the human and they said, this is why we're doing it. And the New York Times a year later found out that what happened there was actually a mapping program guiding that didn't recognize 6 traffic lights. So the self-driving car wasn't supposed to detect the traffic lights. There was a map that it should have relied on, and the map wasn't updated. So it was garbage data, and what happened to Uber. By the way, we will go to Uber once more. Actually, 2 times. Uber is good with machine learning backups. All right, Uber. Yeah, that's Uber again. In Sydney, there was a terror attack on the Sydney siege. It was some guy that took hostage 18 people. I actually don't know what exactly happened, but people tried to escape. And what Uber does, if someone knows, the fare is the fare changes according to the demand. So the demand skyrocketed. It was a rise of by 4 times more. 100 Australian dollars, but still dollars, 100 Australian dollars was the minimum, which is unbelievable. And people just couldn't escape from there. And Uber is truly sorry for the price rise. So what happened here? What do you think? Why it went to the... I think that was the maximum, the 4 times more. What happened here, Uber wanted to have drivers to come and to help with the demand. So this is why the prices... It's in order to encourage the drivers to come. But what happened here, it went to the maximum. And it didn't reduce the car. It happened that they didn't have the data point of such a demand, and it went to the maximum. And it's actually very easy to fix. They could have just anticipated this kind of things and just multiplied by 3 or something like that, and not doing this kind of abusing the terror. Here's an Israeli example. We have this guy, and it's a bad circumstances. Because look, he took a photo with a bulldozer, and we know that a couple of years ago we had lots of terror attacks with bulldozers. And he said, here we see, who knows Arabic? It's very small. Right? It says good morning. But the Facebook translation says, you go by him, and then you can direct it to Gumazan. There's a feedback loop by Facebook. So good morning to attack them. Someone in the Shabak, in the national security, saw this picture and that translation, and he was arrested. He was saying good morning, so it looked like a success. What happened here, the translation was without context, so that actually happened there. Another interesting example, it was a glitch. Before 2010, I was working for a company, with a chief data scientist of a company called Wiser, we did dynamic pricing. So we priced products on Amazon, on eBay, on many Office Depot, that many companies, and we also had a backup over there. We actually, by mistake, reduced prices. We updated an SQL table without emphasizing the condition. So it updated all the clients, not only that client. So we also had glitches, but this one is a very serious one, because for 2 hours, from between 7 and 8, all the prices were 1 penny. Only hundreds of items actually were sold. And the sellers, they asked Amazon to compensate them By the way, this company bankrupt, the Pricer company bankrupt, and Amazon didn't pay for the losses. So that's a very known one. So this guy is saying, Google Photos, you all fucked up. My friend is not a gorilla. You can see here gorillas. And it was 6:22, 6:32, 10 minutes later. He's very curious guy, wants to experiment. So he took many pictures with that girl over here and said, it's only photos that I have with her. Only with her, so she looks like a gorilla. By the way, this was Google. How Google fixed that? Do you have any ideas? Huh? More data? More data. All right, so what they did, they removed the gorilla class. There's no gorilla class, no more mistakes. But I think until this moment, by the way, until now, it's still this way. And we see a bias, so you can see this, that's the error rate. You can see there's no Google, there's Facebook, IBM. There's a Microsoft and IBM, they're very bad. And what is the reason why we're so bad with dark colored people? It's actually the data. It's a weak spot. It's a weak spot of the algorithm. And we will mention weak spots even more. And now I'm going to go back to the Uber thing. Self-driving cars may be more likely to hit you if you're dark skinned. And that's serious, actually. That's, so if you're thinking about the Uber, the first thing with the red light, if you're dark skinned, you have to be very cautious. And it's all because of the weak spot. No, not enough high-quality data. And the quality is very important. Another example, you can see sheep here, all right, that's Azure, that's Azure ML, it detects objects. So you detected sheep, nice, right? It's a nice detection, it's doing very well. By the way, Microsoft are actually doing very well with object detection. And here there's no sheep, but they think that there is sheep. And then this girl that I took this slide from her, she experimented and she put another two pictures. What do you think will happen there? There's no sheep over here, not here. This is Joanne Shane, yeah? Joanne? Janelle, all right. So Janelle, he's from here, so he could escape if he can. All right, so Janelle Shane, how about here? There's no sheep, and still the sheep is there. So what happened here? What is the bias? Huh? Yeah, you see the grass and then the sky over here on the fixed ship, and it's just a total mislabel. It's actually very easy to fix, and it's a mishap by. And there's actually a very nice example of Russian tanks and American tanks. So Russian tanks took pictures, photos of Russian tanks, and the sky was very gray. And in the United States, it was in the desert, so it was like really sunny. And in the end, the model was really good. The precision recall was amazing. And what the model did, it was an artifact, it was a data leakage. What the model did is recognize the sky, right sky against gray sky. So, yeah, you have to be very careful with that. About the data, say, what's your name? Doron said, give me more data, it will be fine. You have a weak spot, let's have more data, and it will be all good. And so if there is a bias with more data, it will be more accurate. If you can say something. So yeah, more data, it's not the quantity, it's the quality. Now we'll give examples afterwards. So my fuck-ups, actually here, checkpoints, right? And now we're going a little bit more to the details. We have internal data that we test ourselves, and it was mixed with the production pipeline. So what happened, our performance were rocketed, they were amazing. It's like the Anaconda video. We had great results. The recall and precision were amazing. And for some time, I actually thought that it's too good to be true, but for months we thought that's the case. And what actually happened, we knew the data, we knew the, it was previously known, we knew the answers. It's like having a test with what you know the answers for. And it took us a while to get to the bottom of it. Oh, wow, more people coming. You missed a lot. And another thing, the important feature wasn't retrieved, so it's like driving with a free wheel and one wheel is not there. So we depended on one of the sources, another model, machine learning model from another team, and they put it in another place in the JSON that we pass. And what happened, we didn't have this feature. And it was really, really tricky to find out because some of the for some of the cases we did have, so it was a missing value, and we didn't find it in time. And actually, what it's resulted with bad performance. And last interesting, and it happens a lot. You need to be really monitoring your data. By the way, all these fuckups, I have a solution for them. So don't worry, there is a solution for all of them. Another one, our brand. We have a brand roof now in cyber. By the way, with cyber, you saw the project we have. We're doing a lot. We're doing deep learning. We're doing NLP-based models, and we have execution executables and PDFs and stuff like that. So we have very interesting data, but the label is time-dependent. Right? Today is malicious. Tomorrow it's not going to be malicious. It changes all the time, and we have to be updated with the label. And the label is really time-dependent and depends on many, many factors. So what happens? It's like, I don't know if you can see here. The date is 13 May 2014. Who wants to eat hummus that was so updated? So what happened, our ground truth were months outdated, and we actually updated the ground truth in 3 days to 1 month. So it was really, really bad, and we also thought that we were very good on all data. And in the end, we had to monitor it, and we have to run validations. So what is the, there's more challenges. So there's data provenance. It's very important. It's like data governance. What is the origin? How it was collected, data versioning, now we started to do a kill checkpoint. We're versioning the data. This input came from this specific vendor, from this specific app, from this specific stream of data. Can I trust it? Data quality, is the data error-free, which is really difficult to, especially when you have terabytes of data. How you validate all that? Data bias, does the data accurately reflect the population we wish to model? Like, would we have the weak points? There is a bias in the data because there is a bias in is there a bias? And it's very, it's very difficult to find it, but I will show you some ways. And model bias. By the way, if you have bias in data, you will have bias in model, but it doesn't have to be. Even if your data is perfect, it can happen as well, driven by unconscious bias. So what is the solution? By the way, before I'm giving my solution, what do you think, what is the solution for all of this? Anyone? Any idea? The one? More data? No? That's the problem. Shy? Huh? Who said it? You had the meetup on data validation. So like, this guy's like, yeah, DDDA. Alright, what else? Monitoring, very important. More ideas? Clean the data, very important. What? Continuous what? Continuous monitoring, alright, that's good. Okay, so I am saying more data crunching, less speed predict. So monitoring is important once it's in production stuff. Right? You need to monitor your model, that's 100% sure. I'm talking right now on the data part, like before even I have any model. Right? More data crunching, less speed predict. I can see people run to do some kind of like initial model, MVP, and then they're stuck. And then suddenly this MVP is the end product. So actually right now I told you that there are 60 products in the checkpoint. There are 13 machine learning AI-based products right now. And many of them are MVP. They're really, really early stage. And for some reason, they stay for that long time. Because the second iteration is not that easy to do. Especially when so we have to be very careful with our first MVP. And test-driven methodology, I will mention, and I will go into details about that, and less tech models. I can see many junior data scientists, what they do, they like meta models. Let's put logistic, linear, light UDM, and something deep learning, and then put on top of that another logistic, something like that. You can see it all the time. And that's maybe the easiest solution. We need to be very, very careful with that. It's very difficult to, it's complex, it's hard to train, hard to validate. It's an issue. Don't do that. Unless you really have to. All right, so what is test-driven data science? Unit tests, very important. We've simulated our example data. Sanity tests. Sanity tests that check your main requirements, and if it doesn't pass the sanity test, you need another unit test. By the way, can you give me an example to a sanity test? Go on. All right, accuracy level, if it's RPC, it's not very good, but you run them, okay, it's in the model. Another idea? That's each one, yeah.
Same number of columns.
Huh?
Same number of columns, types of columns.
Sanity, number of columns, some kind of, okay, what else? By the way, any tools that you know, that you were using? Yeah. You using any tool? No?
Yes.
No, no, all right. How many of you familiar with banana test? Banana test. No? So it's interesting, when you have a project like NLP, topic classification, sentiment, whatever, and your data, you know for sure that in your data there is no banana. There is no banana in your data set, right? There is no banana in your T5DF, there is no banana there. No banana in BERT, not in GLAB. Actually, maybe if you do transfer learning, you have banana there. And I will give you an example for sanity test. Let's say I'm doing a topic classification. If there is a banana in my text, that means that I'm not going to give any topic because I don't have any topics for that. So I want my model to retrieve that there is unknown topic. I don't want it to give any results. So that's kind of a sanity test. You want to test your algorithm for these use cases that you shouldn't get them. And then if suddenly you get a topic for banana that it's classified as malicious, toxic banana, you then will have to be very careful about what's going on, and then you have more sanity tests, and this is iteration. And very important, data integrity. Data integrity, that means that you check your input and your output all the time. This is the input that you should receive, that's the output. Data integrity is very, very important. And you don't want to get F minus on this one. All right. So there is a proposed solution. It's called Octopus. Know your data. Why Octopus? Because it has many arms. And when you're testing your data, you need this, you need those arms. You need the data validation, you need the data crunching, an initial EDA, you need to detect artifacts and inconsistencies in data. Usually the feature examination, the importance and anomalies you're doing once you have a model, but I'm going to propose a new way to test it without any model, to use my tool. That's right now not available for you, but hopefully will. I'm going to give you a teaser about something that is not available. Hopefully will. I need to, it's actually an ongoing work, and once it will get approved, we're going to put it on the GitHub in the public one. Detection of data leakage, very important. Data leakage, the example with the ship is a data leakage, the example with the tanks, the sky is a data leakage. And data integrity, very, very important. So now I'm going to
video.
Here. I will show you the data frame. So we'll go very quickly. By the way, before Octopus, I want to show you some examples that are some tools that are available and people use it quite a bit. So what we have here, I took I actually wanted to show you more interesting data, but the data is, I can't show it here, even if white label it, it's difficult to understand. So I decided to go on bike sharing data. It's bike sharing Kaggle competition. It was active 4 years ago, and I'm using this data. It's very interesting. It's a time series, and the target is to detect, not to detect, to it's a regression to predict the number of orders any station will have, based on the weather, based on the holiday, work day, temperature, and the location. So that's the data how it looks like. How many of you use Pandas? Nice. All right. Continue. Actually, we're thinking to have another meetup with PyData in October or November, and we're going to talk about how to take Pandas all the way to production and make it very, very robust. Okay, so there is a method called Scribe, and it's very, very nice. You should use it. What it gives you the account, the mean, the STD. It's like a box plot for each one. It's like a textual box plot for each one of the of the variables. Very nice. But there is something nicer, and it's called Data Frame Summary. It's from Pandas Summary. It's addition to Pandas. And what it does, it's really, really nice. It adds unique, missing percent, and times. Look how nice it is. You can see that the holiday, there's only two, you don't need even to see the head, you don't need to see the data, but you can see it right away. There are only two unique values. And season, there's only four. And the temperature, actually, it's very interesting. There's only 49 unique values there. Missing values, you can see that casual is missing by 28%. Nice number, 28.28. And by the way, the data is pretty good by Kaggle. In order to give you an example of what I'm of my tool that I'm going to want you to use, the octopus. So I did some tweaking and I added constant feature. We get just one all the time. Like if you had something, and we had such a problem. Instead of getting a result from one of the agents, we got a constant value. And this is very easy to find it. There's a cheat feature, a simple one, and a robust one. Right? And I will show you why I had the robust one. So, DFS, called the data frame summary. Really, really nice. You can find it on GitHub, widely used. Who knows and used pandas profiling? Okay. Pandas profiling is nice. And octopus is in some way it's like a shlaman, mashlimet pandas profiling. It's like a completion of the pandas profiling. If pandas profiling was good, I would use pandas profiling. But you will see what's going on here. So pandas profiling gives you on this data frame, on the Kaggle one, it shows you the number of features, 15, number of observations, the total missing values, even the size and memory, nice. And then it gives you warnings. A temperature is very highly correlated with temperature. So that's the air temperature temperature. That's nice. Casual has lots of zeros. A cheat feature robust, you could find it, but it just gives you a warning about missing values. By the way, this cheat feature is a very, very naughty one, and you will see what's going on with that one. And pandas didn't find that something was really wrong with this feature. Cheat feature simple, highly correlated, and it was rejected. So pandas profiling did a good job here. By the way, can you see it or you want me to enlarge it a little bit? Huh? Small, right? So why not telling you this one? Yeah, let's get it a little bit. It's 80%. Now it's better, right?
No.
You
believe
it? No, I want you to see octopus. Yeah, now it's very good. Hopefully that's a little better. It's a big auditorium, but small screen. Sorry about that. Okay. And by the way, there are many histograms over here, and you can see that this one is skewed. Lots of nice stuff. Use pandas profiling. In the end, there's a correlation one. See, there's a Pearson correlation. You can see it's pretty nice. I will show you mine, it's a bit better. All right. Another one, missing info visualization, MSNO. Really nice one. It gives you a visualization. Data frame summary. So what you can see here, I'm sorry it's too large, I will increase it a little bit. And this one. Well, so what you can see here, it's a representation of how the features look. You see the feature and the missing values. What you can see here, the casual one, it's a nice example of there was missing value, and then suddenly there was a value. So there was a bug over here, and you can see it's not like missing value like that, or like the wind spin or something like that. It's like a bulk. There was a bug here, and then suddenly it was fixed. So it's a nice visualization, so you can see right away what's going on. I use it a lot. Missing info visualization, very nice one. And Yotam, DDDA, all right. So only Yotam knew what DDDA is, now everyone knows, that's nice. Test-driven data analysis, it's a huge package, really nice things, unit test, PyTest, lots of stuff. I took one thing that I actually took it from Yotam presentation. So what I took is the constraints. I use these constraints when I train new data. So I have old data, and when you retrain your data, like every 3 weeks or 2 weeks, whatever, I have it constraints on the first model of the first data that I was training. And look what's going on there. So it's DDDA constraints. I'm building the constraints on the extreme, and here's the constraints, how it looks like. It looks like it gives me the date, and it gives me the field, what are the constraints. For instance, season, it's integer, mean 1, maximum 4, it's positive. Max null, there was no null there. Holiday, it was integer, one max, workday. So for each feature, it gives me the constraints. Right? So if I'm using it, now I'm training new data, I can see if there's any chariga, I'm sorry, is there any?
Okay.
No,
okay,
yeah. Yeah.
I'm
not on the data. For Atlas, I have something else, but if there is any gaps, so it's nice, and it builds for me all automatically. And then I can verify. And what I did, I decided to verify the new data. And I decided to do some training tests. And look what happened. The tests are all automatic. There were 45 tests that were passed, and there were 5 tests that were missed. You can see what was missed. You can actually do it in data frame. You can also see what happened there. So temperature, there were 3 passes, 1 failures. My chip features are very bad. They fell a lot. So they failed one time, and you can see they failed on, I think, maximum or something like that. I will say on time. All right, thanks. All right. So that's a very nice, and by the way, you can also know your data means that you actually look, you take one instance, one observation, and you actually go over it. It's very, very important. So what you can do here, you can actually run it on the new data, and you can see all the detected gaps. It's not anomalies, but all the detected harigot. Sorry, I didn't find a nice word for that. Really, really nice. So actually, you took a new data set, and you can see what's going on over there. And now, I'm proudly to present Know Your Data Octopus. Right, here it is. I have 2 expectations. It's very easy, and it's very, very basic. Keep it simple. And you should. And it's important to use it because it's very accessible. Modern language. You can take it. You don't need to do any. There's almost no dependencies. It works nice. So I took the same data frame. And I decided to add to the balance profile. So what I have is, first of all, train test feature stream. It's passed. That's the only thing that passed it. Train test data leakage. I'm checking if there is an instance that are the same, exactly the same, or very close to the data, to the training. If there is exactly the same instance in test and train. So by the way, you can tweak it. There is a level distance for NLP or for you can tweak the distance how you want it, because every problem is a little bit different. The default, by the way, is exact match. And I will show you what's going on here. There's many exact match. And then the feature con feature, it's constant, so I'm not checking it. Cheat feature is an artifact. That's the robust one. I found that it's a problematic one. Balance profile indeed. The simple one is the simple one. And wind spin is left skewed, just be aware that it's left skewed. And also, total number of duplicates, there's 11% duplicates. It's exactly the same features in your data. So when you do rigor precision, suddenly there's lots of effect. Yeah. What is cheat feature? Right, I will actually. So what I did with cheat feature is a feature that is highly correlated to the highly correlated to you with the target. That's what I did, and it's a data leakage kind of example. So actually, in order to generate it, I just multiplied the target by a certain number. It's very highly correlated, so that was a cheat feature. And for us, it's very, very important because we have lots of them. It can be the sky thing or actually there is a very interesting talk about how to find these artifacts and cheat features. And then you can see that this, you can see here, it's not a nice representation, it will be better when you release it as a package. So you can see the features, and you can see that there were 343 instances, exactly the same. 13 exactly the same instances here. This data is very, very redundant, and it happens a lot. And we need to be careful, even with Kaggle. By the way, here I generated, it's not the real data. But there are several Kaggle competitions that have the same data. And I did correlation because pandas profiling also have. And you can see here a really nice one that, for instance, the workday and casual. So yeah, they correlated negatively because if it's a workday, there's no casual users. Or holiday, let's take another one, temperature and register. And the higher the temperature, the more people are riding the bike. That's in Washington. In Israel, it might be not the case. Maybe it's too high. There is another more robust correlation that you actually can see the histograms, and it hues the colors against the season. So you can see, for instance, casual users here. That's casual users, and that's the number of users renting the bike. You can see that in the summer, that's the summer color, there are more casual users. So it's a nice one, it's a very nice correlation. And this one is for the working days, exactly the same. Another one, you have your data, right? And you don't, in the first analysis, you didn't even train your model, nothing. And by the way, I can ask if you want the Lasso, if you want LightGBM, if you want Underforce, if you want sharper values, whatever, I can give it to you. And for instance here, that I'm training in the behind the scene, very simple model, and I can give you some feature importance, and you can see chief feature is number one, the artifact. One last thing, that's one last thing. So that's really nice if you want to see the feature importance. And one last thing is the anomalies. How many of you are familiar with isolation force? Not so many. At least try it, it's very nice. I don't know how new it is, but it's very easy. Isolation force finds you anomalies, finds you the instances that are really, really different from other ones. And it finds it by looking at the tree, the one that go out, the one that get out in the first split. It's a very straightforward way. I'm implemented here isolation force. And by the way, here it's a default one. I just told Octopus anomalies, data frame, and the columns, the columns that I want you to check. And it just prints it by itself. You can actually tweak it and you can see what kind of anomalies you want to see. And it gives you all the anomalies. So you actually can do data crunching. So this is Octopus for now. There are much more features coming. And by the way, if you want to add a feature, once it's going to be a package and it's going to be open source, you will be able to add your own things. But if you have any suggestions, I would like to hear. That'd be great. And I think I have 5 minutes to questions. Yeah, all right. The question is, can I make a newsletter to update when it's released? I will update in the meetup, yeah. Hopefully it will be soon. Right now we're waiting for approval from one of the VPs to put it in the open source. Yeah.
I didn't quite understand, how do you verify production data? Mm-hmm.
Say it again?
You talked about data verifying, validating data. How do you do it?
How do you validate the data? So you can use the, not Octopus, but TDDA, one of the tools, and you can do constraints, and then you can make sure that it's actually within the constraints. And also this kind of work, but then you check out the feature importance, you check out the cheat features and the anomalies. It gives you more access to your data. In the end, you want access to your data, and you don't want to be in data shop. You don't need access to all data. You want to access to the outlier kind of data. And not outlier by one univariate. You want to do it much more robust. So this set of tools, it's not one tool. It's one of these tools that you should do one after another. And correlation as well. Yeah, question? You will need to yell. I'm sorry, you're very powerful. What do you do when?
I'm asking about the case where you have multiple features, like thousands of features. You can't go one by one and you can't design the exact.
Let's say you have a TFID of features or something like that, and then it's a vocabulary of 10,000. That's a challenging one, but what you can do, you actually can, what you actually can do, you can do feature importance and stay only with, there's usually when you do feature importance on many features, you will have a long tail. So you just focus, just focus on the features that are actually important to the model. That's one of the solutions. But yeah, we actually, for Octopus, there is a new feature that we want to add for NLP.
But your feature
especially for NLP, yeah.
For feature importance, it means you already trained the model.
No, you sit here in Octopus. You can get it. I'm training a model for you. All you need is just give me the label. I will train it with many different models. And then I will generate the feature importance for you. So you can, and then you can focus on your data. Yeah. You can use it as well. Maybe it's not going to be as good as your model, but it's initial hunch. We'll give you some idea of your data. Another two questions, and then I will be here to answer more questions. So two questions. Yeah. Yeah, so I implemented, I actually went to, I Yeah, data leakage. Data leakage is an interesting one because there's some really, really tough data leakages and you need to be very careful. Especially, it depends on your model. If you're using deep learning model, well, you can find yourself with interesting data leakages. So I'm using three different techniques. One of them is just to see the similarity between test and train. So that's the easiest one. And another two ways there, a little bit too long to explain, but we can meet afterwards and I can explain. And by the way, when it will be released, I will elaborate on them. Yeah, data leakage is for us in Checkpoint, it's crucial. Because once you have data leakage, you're in la la la, you think you're great, and then after a couple of hours, the model in production gets lots of false positives. Another question? All right, I think we all said thanks very much for coming. Let's take for a few 10 minutes break, and then Asaf is going to talk about Asaf is going to talk about week supervision. Right, thanks.